Hamilton 1971, 125 years old, a century and a quarter of growth and development, dwarfed by today's massive commercial and industrial complex, mushrooming daily, changing inevitably. But the Hamilton we know today exists primarily because of the groundwork laid out over the past 125 years, just as the future is being born today.
People will be coming to Hamilton because of all the facilities that we're going to have. We're going to have facilities of a metropolitan city without all the headaches that come when your population gets into the millions.
The year 1781. The American Revolution is virtually over. Into New York, the last British stronghold in the colonies, flowed thousands of refugees, loyalists who would not and could not support the rebels. Many of them went back to England. Some moved to the Canadian Maritimes, others to Bermuda, and yet another group set out for Fort Niagara in the West. On August the 4th, Peter Secord began farming on the Canadian shore of the Niagara River, the first of the loyalists to do so. Settlement quickly leapfrogged from Fort Niagara along the Lake Ontario shoreline, the less accessible land being left for later arrivals. The better land was soon taken, and before ink had dried on the new land purchases, settlers were pushing further down the lake into the land not yet surveyed. George Stewart and his young brother-in-law, Charles Depew, joined this further thrust of settlement. They left Fort Niagara one warm summer day in 1785, paddled their canoe along the lake shoreline to where the land grant ended, then portaged the beach strip and entered Lake Geneva, now called Burlington Bay. When they came to a deep inlet, later Stipes Inlet, they staked their claim for squatters' rights in Depew's name. Then they paddled westward, up the bay to stake Stewart's claim, lying east and west of the present Sherman Avenue. But a baby born to each family prevented their move for a year. By that time, John Depew and his family was already established on 935 acres of land. Today, that land holds most of Hamilton's heavy industry. Soon, a fourth settler came to the Bay Area, Robert Land, loyalist and British courier. He had become hopelessly separated from his wife and children at the end of the Revolution. He ended up at Fort Niagara and they in New York. Eventually, he became resigned to his solitary life and existence, and they to the fact that he must be dead. But by some quirk of chance, Land's family heard of the lonely man at the head of the lake, and they were reunited. Land prospered in his new homestead, now the area of Beach Road and Leeming Street. To the west, a fur trader and merchant, Richard Beasley, had built a log cabin and store. Beasley arrived on the land, later to become the site of Dundurn Castle about 1785. As the century ended, Lieutenant Governor John Simcoe had an inn built at the southern end of Burlington Beach. The King's Head Inn became an important stop between York, the provincial capital, and Niagara, and a growing community was well on the way to becoming a town. Houses and farms were cropping up as quickly as land could be cleared. Several families built their homesteads on the escarpment. Thomas Gent located on 300 acres at Albion Falls. William Davis built a grist mill on the mountain, and Jacob Burkholder selected his land because escarpment sites had fewer trees to clear. His farm was in the area of Upper Sherman and Mohawk Road. Meanwhile, at the northeastern corner of the bay, one of Upper Canada's most colorful figures built his home. Tyon Denega, or as he had been renamed Chief Joseph Brant, erected a stately mansion on a grassy plain. One of the province's first citizens, Brant was at home to the powerful members of the Family Compact, which controlled the government. He had been received by the king, and Indian canoes were always beached in front of his open door. The tiny community was prospering. The century turned, and the Revolution and its unpleasant memories had all but vanished from the minds of early colonists. But the smoldering animosity between the United States and England flared once again. Simcoe had foreseen the hostilities and knew that Canada could not help but become involved. Once again, families were divided. and friends found themselves fighting friends. Britain was pouring all of her resources into the Napoleonic Wars. Little was available for the defense of Canada. General Isaac Brock, commander of the Upper Canada Militia, had under him only a handful of trained soldiers and an undisciplined mass of farmers and colonists. Each man had to supply his own musket or rifle, cartridges and knife. There were no supplies in the king's stores, and when the men of the town went to war, they had to carry their own. The Americans burned York, the provincial capital, on their way to capture Fort George at the mouth of the Niagara River. The fleet paused just long enough to burn the king's head in. It was the only action that the town of Hamilton actually saw in that war. The British fell back to Burlington Heights. In June, the Americans moved forward. They reached Stony Creek on June the 5th and drank the town well dry. But more important than Stony Creek were the Burlington Heights. If they fell, all of Canada from Niagara to Kingston would fall to the Americans. At 40 Mile Creek, the Americans were routed. Further battles at Lundy's Lane and Queenston, where the young Brock lost his life, ensured independence for Upper Canada. Once again, the community at the head of the lake settled down to farming and commerce. The peace gave rise to urban growth, and a young Queenston man moved his family to Hamilton. The man, George Hamilton. Hamilton bought 257 acres from James Durant, who was leaving to open a business near Belleville. The land Hamilton purchased now forms the nucleus of the city. Scarcely had he and his family settled on the land than the provincial legislature granted the community the status of town. Because the land owned by Hamilton had been opened up first, the new town would bear his name. Hamilton built a courthouse jail himself in 1816. Located on the corner of Jackson and John Streets, the courthouse had little activity save land sales. 10 years later, the community had grown so much a new jail courthouse was built. The focal point of Hamilton in the 1820s was Gore Park, a pleasant retreat in the heart of a bustling town. In 1819, the Upper Canada Legislature passed an act establishing a public school in Hamilton, but it was 2 years before that school opened. Located at the corner of Houston and Jackson Streets, it soon had a reputation as one of the best in the country. Then tuition was £1 sterling. The town was growing. Hotels and public houses increased in number. Shops were expanding, and the Burlington Canal was opened. But that canal nearly spelled doom for Hamilton. In 1832, it brought the plague. Hurriedly, the townspeople met at the courthouse, agreed to burn garbage, scrub homes and houses and public buildings, and disinfect cesspools. But it was useless. And the death carts carried the still corpses to mass graves. But, like all tragedies, it passed. A police station and public market were built. But now the population had reached 1,400. In another year, it leaped to 2,000. And a year after that, it had grown to 2,600. Then, suddenly, in 1836, the city's founder, George Hamilton, died at the age of 49. He was buried at the family plot, alongside his wife, on the mountainside at the head of Ferguson Street. Hamilton's place at the forefront of civic affairs was filled by a young lawyer, Mr. Napier McNabb. McNabb had prospered in the community. He bought land, ran for the legislature, and won. And he was one of the most well-known lawyers in Upper Canada. So prosperous was he that McNabb commissioned the building of a Grand Regency castle on land he had acquired from Richard Beasley. In 1835, the McNabbs moved into Dundurn Castle, and the young Tory soon became the chief spokesman of the government. Dundurn has had a long and varied history of its own. Rad Weaver was born at the castle, and he remembers the day when it was still a private home.
You have a unique distinction. You're perhaps the only living person in Hamilton who was born on the grounds of Dundurn Castle.
Before the city purchased it. That's true.
How many years ago?
1896, and the city purchased it in 1899.
Now, at that time, this was a lot different, this property.
Oh, yes. Yes. Great changes have been made. Modernized it, you know. And saving the building, remodeling it. It's beautiful.
Now, this was owned by a private individual at one time. Now, I'm not talking about Sir Alan McNabb, of course, but prior to this change over to the city.
Yes, Senator McInnes purchased it from the estate of Sir Alan McNabb. And at that time, my dad looked after all the parks for Senator, or the grounds of Senator McInnes.
Were some changes made between now and then? There used to be a big fence around here, didn't there?
Right from the Sophia Street, it was called then, which is now Strathcona, right out to the past Harvey Park. Right around the whole place. And there was one gate here, where you come in around that point of the picket fence, and then the other entrance was at the front where the big stone pillars are right present. There used to be a cottage, a small cottage, just to the right of those pillars years ago.
How about the trees and the shrubbery and all this greenery we see?
Well, a lot of the trees are still here, but a lot of them have gone. It hasn't changed much in the grounds other than the, we'll say, the planting of trees.
Now, there's an umbrella tree that we can see from where we are that looks to be quite old.
Well, that tree, I would say, is closer to 200 years old than it is 150. There's only two of those in the park. The other one is by the battery lodge up there.
You must have had an awful lot of fun here as a kid, having this place as your playground.
That wasn't the word. We had fun galore. Downstairs in that basement, all the bells, the parties we used to have. It was really fantastic. And you made your own fun in those days. I couldn't even begin to tell you the marvelous time we did have as youngsters in this place.
There were some inconveniences, I'm sure. Nothing in the way of plumbing, really.
Oh, well, in those days, that was entirely different. In the, in our bedroom, up the stairs, the one large room, that we had four beds, one in each corner. The bathroom and toilet was off, but that was all tin. There were tin baths in those days, and it was entirely different what it is today.
You probably have some views about the battery house. This, once in a while, people say, let's tear it down, other people say, let's keep it going. This is actually where you were born before you lived in the castle.
That is true. No, I think with the development downtown Hamilton today, the Jackson Square, what we're doing, I have said this long before they started that. I think this should be taken away for one reason. They would save, I would say, down. They could relieve traffic in the heart of the city practically 10 to 15 minutes every hour, because all they'd have to do is come right through there, merge, keep traffic right on the go. Now, as it stands, if they're going to use this for any other purpose, I think it's going to be a disaster point on account of the traffic that you see passing there right now. And this is the reason why I can't see, of course, they call it the British bastard, and at the same time, we're living in the world of tomorrow, not the world of yesterday.
All these years, while you were growing up here, up to today, what's been the biggest change that you could pinpoint for Hamilton?
Well, Hiro, when you ask a question like that, when you see what's going on in Hamilton today, this is a hard question to answer. Look at the explosions on Hamilton building right now in the heart of your city. Look at this change. All those old buildings coming down, park and parks as we used to remember. There's people in Hobson's on the corner of McNabb and King Street for years and years. Pat Galvin is where the auto parts is today. Andy Bain used to be down across from the Connaught. These were all importers. And in those days, not like today, when we would send our order Friday or Saturday, A bottle of whiskey was ordered with the groceries, or a bottle of gin. Those days, a bottle of gin was about 55 cents for a 40-ounce bottle. And a bottle of whiskey, not much more for a 40-ounce bottle. Everything was imperial measure in those days, not wine measure like they're using here today. Oh, the changes have been, it's hard to explain the changes.
While the galas and political intrigues were continuing at Dundurn, the town of Hamilton was growing rapidly. To keep up with the development, the town council borrowed heavily from European consortiums. Usually, the council members themselves had to post personal assurances that the bonds would be met. They seldom were, and the growth continued. So did the deficit. In 1848, Hamilton became a city, and the debt became even greater. The city had a newspaper. The Spectator began to publish in 1846. A semi-weekly, the paper was peeled from a flatbed press purchased in Kingston by editor Robert Reed Smiley. Eventually, it outsold its modest competition and grew with the city. But with the development and maturing of Hamilton, now with a population of over 10,000, the port of Hamilton flourished. But once again, cholera broke out, the result of the giant wave of immigration sweeping through the city in the 1850s. And as the decade progressed, little improved. In 1857, late one afternoon, the Great Western Railway passenger train from Toronto crashed through the swing bridge spanning the Desjardins Canal on Burlington Heights. 100 people were on board. 59 died that afternoon in the icy water. Rescue work continued through the night and the next day. By the end of the decade, Hamilton was bankrupt. The city debt had skyrocketed. The official bankruptcy papers were filed in 1862, and a bailiff's action was held to raise cash. Streetlights were turned out. Civic salaries were slashed to the bare minimum, and it was still not enough. Finally, all of the assets of Hamilton were sold, many bought by citizens and returned to the city. Eventually, the debt was paid off, and Hamilton was placed on a strong financial footing by a council based on avarice. But yet another menace to the city was looming not far off. June the 1st, 1866, the cry was heard. The Fenians are coming. The Fenians are coming. Hastily, the 265 volunteers of the 13th Battalion of the militia assembled and marched up James Street. The Irish-Americans had taken advantage of the confusion of the American Civil War to launch an attack on Canada to free it from British rule. Newspaper accounts told of the campaign, and cartoonists amused readers with impressions of the Fenians. There was no war, only a skirmish, and it ended with a hasty retreat by the Fenians, but the valor of the 13th was not soon forgotten. On July 1st, 1867, Confederation was born, and Canada grew into nationhood. There was little fanfare, but already Hamilton was becoming the industrial center of the new nation. And with the urban sprawl, it became obvious that public transit was needed. On May the 11th, 1874, the first horse-drawn car left the barns at McNabb and Stewart Streets. The route ran south on James to King and turned east to Wellington Street. So great was civic development in the 1880s that civic administration outgrew its old headquarters and built a new edifice at the corner of Market and James Streets, one of the city's most important intersections. The three-story building with six-story clock tower epitomized the Victorian influence of architecture in Hamilton. It housed all civic government until it too became overcrowded and was replaced in 1960. Social life at the turn of the century was a combination of teas, formal balls, and trips to Toronto to shop. Yet, while Hamiltonians relaxed, another storm was brewing over Europe. Nationalism was emerging, and the old empires were crumbling. When the Austrian Archduke Ferdinand and his wife were assassinated at Sarajevo, the continent was plunged into war. Canada could not help from becoming involved. By the hundreds, Hamiltonians enlisted to fight for a dying way of life, but the one, the only one, which they knew. Lads in their mid-teens were taken as war fever increased. Hamiltonians read with interest of the war which seemed never to end, the war to end all wars. But in the trenches, they fought and bled. And Hamiltonians distinguished themselves in the field. Trench warfare, gas warfare, tanks, a whole new concept in fighting, and the birth of a whole new world. The war ended with a new freedom, a new joy for life, and this was typified by the movies.
Music was important to the era of the silent film, and in Hamilton, 72-year-old Jake Setzer played piano for scores of films and for some of vaudeville's greatest names.
Oh, they don't do songs like that anymore, Jake.
No, that's really a humdinger. That will go on and on and on.
It's a song that's pretty well known by some people as the song of Sophie Tucker.
Yeah, that's her theme song. Some of these days, when she was through at the Brandy Inn in later years, she still sang it. And last time she was on television, she sang it, but she was pretty frail. She sang that when she was through here in the old Temple Theater.
When would that have been?
That would be, in the late 1919, before 20, in there, before the 1920s, in the teens there.
The Temple Theater, Jake, what stands there now?
Well, the Holiday Inn is there now, and that used to be right at the Main Street end of Catherine Street. In front of that is the old terminal station where the bus, originally the radials and then the buses took over. Well, that's all been torn out right now. That Temple Theater was really the top in vaudeville. They were two-a-day, what they call the two-a-day.
That was pretty classy, wasn't
it? Oh, well, there were reserved seats, the orchestra were in tuxedos and all that sort of jazz, you know, and strictly seasonal for the winter season. And then in the summertime, they went into stock, and they went over very, very big. In fact, Jane Seymour played. I don't know whether either she was at the Temple Theater or the Lyric Theater. During summer stuff.
Where was the Lyric?
The Lyric is that one on Mary Street. It's still the Lyric, I believe, isn't it? No, no.
No,
what's it called? Well, that's the one that's on Mary Street there. That's the Lyric Theater. They were running vaudeville, too, and silent movies. Continuous show.
You mentioned a pretty classy vaudeville. Now, there was a 10-20-30 house in Hamilton, wasn't there?
Oh, boy, that was it. That was the old Griffin Theater. That's where I first got my professional playing. It's where Eaton's are now. That's been torn out. And that was a real humdinger. 10 cents up in the gallery and 20-30 cents downstairs. And if they didn't like the acts, they started throwing pennies down, that sort of thing. And there's a lot of memories of that place. On Friday nights was the amateur night, and you've heard the expression, get the hook. Well, that's where they really had a hook, and they hauled them off stage. This hook would come out from the curtains and yank them off. It was really very, very funny. And then Wednesday night was what they call the country store night, and giveaway night. One night in particular, I remember they had a little live pig going about that long. And the thing got away on them. Well, you never saw such a scramble in all your life to retrieve this pig.
Anyway, they got it, and the man I heard later on, the man that won the thing, he had quite a time explaining to the policeman on the beat what he's doing this live pig under his arm that hour of the night. It was really very funny. We had a lot of fun down there.
Who are some of the people you remember that you played for in the pit of a theater like the Pantages, Jay?
Well, we had Bob Hope was through. He was in vaudeville. And Gypsy Rose Lee, she came through several times. In fact, I still have some of the pins that she used when she was stripping down her costume. She'd heave them over into the pit, and I just got a few of them. And Edgar Bergen was through several times with Charlie McCarthy. I don't know whether you remember him or not.
Oh, Mortimer Snurd. Oh, yes. Now, Jake, when you talk about theaters like the Lyric or the Pantages or the Savoy, none of these theaters exist anymore. And the saloons and the hotels, there used to be an awful lot more entertainment here.
Oh, yes. When we were in the 20s there, when we were at the Palace Theater, three or four restaurants in the city had orchestras for the dinner hour. Orchestras, three or four or five men. And then for the after-the-theater crowd, it was quite a thing in those days. And Hamlin was really a swinging place in the 20s, you know. And it, but then that was the end, as you know, in the 29 affair. So things kind of fell pretty flat after that. But in the Palace Theater, the Pantages of that time, it got to be a real home. We were there practically 10 years. And in those 10 years, I think I had 2 weeks off, and that was only... because they brought a piano player with the show. And when you play 6 days a week, 52 weeks a year, spread over 10 years, that's a lot of playing, you know. But we enjoyed it. It was really fun. There's something about a theater, I don't know, they talk about once you're a theater man, you're always a theater. And I believe it. You're always a theater man. There's nothing that seems to take its place, you know, the lights and the applause and... going up and all that sort of thing, you know. And I remember when I was in New York, I saw Hello, Dolly with Pearl Bailey and Cab Calloway, and the opening of that was terrific. Same with Maine, you know, opening up with a big chorus there and the lights and the applause going up. It does something to you. It's really very nice.
Is anybody still left from that pit orchestra that you were in at the Pantages?
I think there are only about three of us left. There's Fred Brandt, played clarinet, and Bill Moore. He does repairing instruments altogether now. And he does a very fine job. He's very well known. They come from far and wide. They bring their violins and their saxes and whatnot, you know. And he does a very good job. That's about all that's left of that gang, I guess.
The talkies had a great effect on Hamilton Entertainment.
Did they ever? That's when I lost my job. We were playing vaudeville, and talkies had been in the States for quite some time. This is the latter part of the 20s. And they finally brought us to Hamilton, and it was in the Palace Theater, and it was such a terrific go that they just cut off the vaudeville, and they just concentrated on talking pictures after that. And as I say, then the 30s came in, and that was the end of the end of an era as far as that's concerned, you know, that show business just went flat after that. And they tried to revive it a couple of times in the late 40s or 50s, and the people just loved it, but I guess they couldn't get the acts, you know. People, the acts would get away from it, and when there's no work, you just go elsewhere, you know. That's what happened to show business.
Has Hamilton gone ahead in your time?
Oh, tremendously, yes. In certain ways, but not in an entertainment way. Because we have lacked facilities for entertainment. Now there's a theater auditorium will probably bring... Now, if we want to see anything at all, we've either got to go to Toronto or to Kitchener. They have an auditorium up there, and they bring really good things through there. So, actually, in an entertainment way, Hamilton has lagged way, way behind in other cities.
The times were free and easy, but not for long. Prohibition arrived, and so did organized crime. Bootlegging flourished in Hamilton. And the self-styled king of the bootleggers was Rocco Perry. But the real brains of the operation was his wife, Bessie. From poverty, they quickly rose to being millionaires. But curiously, Bessie Perry died. The Perrys were well known to the police. And to young Ted Bucket, it was a great case. 86 years old today, Mr. Bucket started out on the Hamilton police force, earning $18 a week. Retired now, he comes back to headquarters to talk with some of the younger men on the force. And he still remembers the night Bessie Perry was murdered.
Well, I was there when they first come to the city. We arrested them for running a house of ill fame on Caroline Street North at Sheaf.
What did they call that part of town?
Well, the row of houses they were in was Bedbug Row. Well, they were prosecuted, fined, and then they went into the bootlegging business. And finally, they had a fleet of cars, not owned by them, paid for by them, but registered in whoever was driving them. So if they were caught, whoever was driving the car was his funeral. But Rocco Perry would pay the fine and fire him for getting caught.
Now, his wife was murdered first, wasn't she?
Yes.
Were there any thoughts at that time as to how it was done or who or anything? Nothing was ever proved.
There was nothing proved. She was shot down in the garage on Bay Street, about 160, 166, I'm not sure of the number. As she got out of the car at night, somebody shot her with a shotgun. He was there too. But he didn't seem too distressed when we got there.
Well,
you can't put that in, I know.
I understand that he sort of suffered under his wife. She was the brains.
She had the money. She kept the money, doled out any to him. He used to complain even to us about that. He stole me. He said, I haven't got a dime. And she got a pocket full of it.
Now, a couple of years later, he too disappeared.
He went where nobody ever found out. Whether they looked too hard or not, I don't know.
The thought was he got a cement blanket in the bay.
Yes, that's the story. Nobody's proved otherwise yet.
But Hamilton was no wide-open city. Indeed, it was quite stable and staid. Industry was increasing at amazing speed. The end of the First World War had meant more time for consumer goods, and Hamilton became the forefront for manufacturing. Hamilton lawyer, Argue Martin, served on council during those years and remembers the way the bustling industrial city of Hamilton was hit by the Depression.
The problems today are tremendous. The problems back in 27 to 31 were not of as great importance. We were just before the 1929 stock market crash, and people generally in Hamilton were well off. Labor at that time, their money they got would purchase far more than today. I think, generally speaking, people in Hamilton, which was then a small town, were happy. They were not confused. They were secure. And in the East End, we had a very large population of people who were not born in Canada. They worked in the great mills. And I say great mills. They're very small compared to our mills today. But They worked down in the East End and were very happy, and they made a tremendous contribution to the growth of Hamilton. I don't know whether the growth of Hamilton is entirely a good thing. It's we've increased in population in the areas which were in existence back in 1927, but our real growth, I think, has been by expanding into other areas and acquiring other areas of land and the populations that lived with them. And I think we've expanded so much. We were then a small, concise, tight little city, and rather a provincial city. We didn't have great outside problems. We had two great assets so far as Canada was concerned at that time, and that was the Tiger football team, which was known throughout Canada, and we had great hockey teams then. Aside from that, we were just a large, prosperous Ontario city. At the present time, of course, it's entirely different. The problems that the city council has to wrestle with in these days are tremendous problems.
I wondered, what were the things that occupied the time of city politicians? I don't think you could have called yourselves career politicians then, even.
No, we were only in power for a few years. That is, except the mayors. Mayor Bill Morrison was in power for many, many years, and John Peebles, all these fellows were, the mayors tended to stay a long time, but the aldermen seemed to come and go, generally speaking. Rather like today, I don't see much change. Vic Copps is in longer, I think, than anybody. Or maybe Lloyd Jackson is as long, but the aldermen changed more. And, of course, the pay was only about $300 a year, as I remember, and that meant that a lot of people, after a few years, found that their time was so taken up that they just resigned and let others have the privilege of running the city.
What about the Tiger Cats at that time? What would be a good crowd to go to a Tiger Cat football game?
Well, of course, the games were played at the cricket ground on Charlton Avenue, and if the weather was good, I think you might get 5,500 for a good game, and for a playoff game, you might get a few more if it wasn't raining. But the people who went there were the people who, they felt it a patriotic duty to go. Particularly the ladies weren't interested in football. They didn't see it in television. They really didn't know really what it was about. But they went because it was a social event. And at halftime, you paraded up in front of the stand and greeted all your friends. And it was quite an event. It was a Saturday afternoon and everybody wore a great big yellow chrysanthemum. We had great teams, of course, and the teams were home boys very largely, almost 100%. And they all had friends, and their friends go to the game, and it was a cohesive, a close type of an afternoon and of an athletic contest. Today it is entirely different.
There is this note in your mind, in your voice now, of what a contrast with today. Are you one of those that feels that if we get too big, we get too impersonal?
It's true that back in the 20s, I suppose Hamilton had a population of around 100,000 people, but the people in the center of the city all knew one another, the business people, and the pace was more measured, and it seemed to be a very pleasant and secure society. Today, the city is so big that one hardly knows more than a few passers-by. You can walk around King and James Street and shop, and you rarely run into very many people you know. And, of course, another thing that hurts that ancient idea of being close to other people is the fact that our buildings now are bigger, and everything we have is bigger. We have supermarkets, and one goes there instead of to the little stores. We all had our favorite little stores back in the 1920s. The drugstore was here, and the butcher shop was here, and we met in places like that. Today, we're all over the place. We may be out at shopping centers. We may be in the mountain, the East End, the West End. We have no central core, really. We have a central core in the sense that geographically it's there, but the people don't necessarily go there. They go all over. Hamilton has expanded so much. And that's going to be one of our troubles, because the city, as it grows larger, and it will continue to grow larger, if it carries on as at present, we're going to have more big buildings and more concentration of buildings, and the people are going to feel that the buildings are more important than they are. They're losing a sense of identity. People come and go, they live and die, and really not much attention is paid to them. Now, that didn't used to be the case. I'm opposed, basically, to large, high-rise buildings. I think that they are not good for the city, and they are not good for people. I know you've got to have places to live in, and they're relatively inexpensive. But it is better for people to be on their own, to be independent, and not just a number amongst a mass of people. That's one of the troubles I think we're having psychologically with people today. They're lost.
At the time of that depression, that market crash in 1929, how did we cope with the welfare demands then?
Well, the welfare demands in the great crash were not too great. It is true that there were lineups for food, and there undoubtedly was hardship. But remember, Canada was growing a bit. You've got to have steel, and Hamilton is a basic town. Our people were, lots of them were out of work, and it was a bad time. We had lineups, but the money seemed to be available either from the city coffers, and of course the private individuals made contributions. I think, relatively speaking, it was almost as bad as it is, for instance, today. But it didn't cost as much to keep people on welfare. We didn't spend as much money. There was nothing to spend it upon. Money bought far more. As a result, I think that the Depression then wasn't really as bad, because another thing, people were much closer to each other. They helped each other. Now, the people who are on relief and in trouble, really, many of them practically have no friends. Must be very difficult. I know it's difficult.
And over the last perhaps 10 or 15 years, there has been a great influx of people from other lands into Hamilton. Most people feel that it's done a great deal of good. And I wonder what your feeling on that is.
Well, I think the contribution made by the newcomers to Hamilton has been tremendous, tremendous. One only has to go down to the East End and the North End. It used to be very, very quiet. Now it isn't. And of course, one reason, many of these people came here because we are a basic steel city. And they could get employment, and it was usually steady employment at quite high wages, at relatively high wages. That's why they came here. And of course, Hamilton was the center of the cheap power for Ontario. We got our manufacturing industries here because of our cheap power and because of the harbor, the fact that shipping was possible, and basic elements, all sorts of stuff that came in on ships could come here more easily, more cheaply, in larger amounts than elsewhere. That was power and water that built up Hamilton. And in its wake, these people who are not Canadians came here and settled, and they've been a tremendous acquisition to this city. Still are.
Speaking about the harbor, man and boy, a lot of things has happened to that harbor. In your lifetime, how long ago was it that we could swim in that harbor? And the bathhouse on the other side that's now abandoned over by Burlington.
I don't know. I never swam in the harbor. I fell in it once about 5 years ago, and wouldn't care to swim in it for a long time. The harbor is today an industrial harbor. It's very hard to have a harbor that is equally useful for industry and also used for recreation. It's practically impossible. I don't think I've ever seen one. I think I've seen practically all the great harbors in the world, and they are all like our Hamilton Bay. You can't have both. But you can change the harbor. Nothing dies. You can bring it back to life. You can make it a lovely place for sailing and swimming if you don't want to have industry. But I think one of the problems today is to create jobs for our people. And if I have to choose between a clean harbor and a lot of jobs for people in Hamilton, I'll take the jobs.
Throughout the 30s, the TH&B Railroad was busy building spur lines off to all the factories which were sprouting up along the waterfront. The Port of Hamilton was greatly expanded, and the City Council went on a campaign to bring industry to the city. Otis Elevator was one of the first. Others were the Grasselli Chemical Company of Cleveland, which later became Canadian Industries Limited, Frost Wire, later to be absorbed by an expanding steel company of Canada, and there was Dofasco. For 50 years, Ralph Parisi worked for Dominion Foundries and Steel. He's retired today, but he still remembers the long hours, low pay, and hard work that seemed like heaven to an immigrant with little cash in his pocket, but a head full of dreams.
Decided to come in Hamilton. I figured there was only one foundry. It was two foundry. And if you had a fight with a boss, you had no place else to go. So I figured I'd come to the big city. And the most thing I got a surprise when I come in here, over there was no fruit any kind, you know. When I left the old country, it was a lot of fruit where I come from, you know. There's nothing to eat over here, no fruit, you know. When I got into Hamilton, I was surprised, you know, to see the peaches and the pear and watermelon and mushroom, you know, pepper, you know. I was surprised in my life. Yes, it's not just like the whole country, you can grow the stuff in here, see?
So this is why you have this garden of yours.
Yeah, that's right, you know. And I went to church, and I figured I was in Italy, you know, all the mass, you was in the Latin, you know. When I sat in the church, I thought there was sitting in the whole country, the same thing, you know. I think it was beautiful. And I like Hamilton. It's a beautiful city. I go all over, but Hamilton, I like it. We got a lovely park and everything else, you know. I used to go up the mountain and walk all up the mountain when it was hardly anything, just farmland. I used to walk right up to the sanatorium. I used to walk. And it was nothing. Like the people today don't walk, but I used to walk all over. Dundon Park, you know, I used to enjoy up Dundon Park, enjoy myself. On a Sunday, I used to go swim right down the bottom of Dundon Park.
Tabasco grew in the times, and you were there 52 years.
52 years. And, the plant really was hardly only few people working in there. And it was the top then they worked. Now, the younger generation have very easy, good money, and very little bit of work they do now down the plant.
Now, the boss used to work for you once in a while.
Yeah, the boss used to work, he used to come and help shaking out the flask, the box, what they call them, you know? Shaking out, you know? Everybody had to work them day. They work hard, you know? If you didn't work, where you go? But now, the young generation, they're real having easy.
Now, how many hours did you work then, and how much did you get paid?
Well, yes, about $3 a day. I used to work 11 hour and 13 hours sometimes. Work Sunday, every day.
No holidays?
No holiday, you know. But now it's lots of holiday, you know. 8 hours a day, that's a lot of change in 50 years. I'm talking over past 50 years, so a lot of change in the last 50 years.
How much were you paid per hour back then?
35 cents an hour. 35 cents an hour. Now they're getting $4 an hour. They say, no, you don't get no pay. It's $4 an hour. They don't get no money now, you know?
If you had it to do it over again, would you change anything?
Oh, yeah, I would. I went to school. When I came in here, I want to ask the priest, I want to go to school. Hey, he says, you talk good English, you don't need to know school. And you are right now, you know? I mean, I would win the school. I would learn how to talk English better and stuff like that. You know, I would improve myself, you know? But I think I done all right without, you know? But I would have been better, you know? Better if I went to school with this country, you know? Than having to go to... But I got by just the same, you know?
In 1939, Hitler invaded Poland, and Hamilton once again sent her men to war in a European fight, which was to eventually spread round the world. On September 1st, the telegram arrived in Hamilton, mobilize. In the first 10 days of the war, 1,500 Hamiltonians enlisted. Before that war ended, another 19,000 would join them. Of a force of more than 20,000 men, one-fifth were killed, wounded, or declared missing. Hamilton industry was caught up in the war effort. National Steel Car was pressed into action, making shells, gun mountings, tank parts, universal carriers, and truck bodies. The knitting mills which dotted the city manufactured uniforms and personal equipment. Firestone went into action building tires for army trucks. In some way, every company in Hamilton contributed to the war effort. In Europe, the forces rising from near defeat were pressing on, driving the Germans back into the Rhineland. Then the news came. Factory whistles, foghorns, and church bells welcomed peace, and the husbands and fathers of Hamilton came home. Parade wagons were quickly pressed into service, and the soldiers' triumphant return was greeted by throngs of citizens, jubilant, reunited. But the peace brought other things. There was unemployment at the factories as they returned to normal production. Necessities were still restricted, and in general, Hamilton evolution moved only in a crawl. Change was needed, and needed quickly. Sam Lawrence, long a champion of the laboring class, had been elected mayor. Lawrence had himself been a labor leader, and in fact had been dubbed Mr. Labor by his supporters. The population grew again. Wartime houses cropped up at the city's east end to house war families. As industry rolled back to pre-war products, more and more workers were brought back. Hamilton's economy grew, and the growth cycle was on the steady march forward once again. people once more had the time to watch the Tigers play football. On a Saturday afternoon, a cannonball could have been fired down King Street without hurting anybody. Everybody was at the game. While Hamilton's menfolk were at the game, the ladies were tuned to the radio, listening in on the lives of hundreds of people just like them.
Evening in Glen Falls. Ruth Wayne, Big Sister, has been sitting in the living room for some time. And now she realizes that subconsciously she's been waiting, waiting for a footstep on the porch, waiting as if John were just away on a late call and not hundreds of miles away.
Live radio was important in those days, too. And the big name among women in Hamilton was Jane Grey.
War was on, and I had to come here on business. And I brought my grandchild with me, little Chris. He was about four then, and, you know, like all the war babies. When's Daddy coming home? Never seen his daddy. When the war's over, when the war's over. The minute we alighted from the platform, from the train, everybody was singing and dancing and hugging each other. Somebody came up and hugged me. The war's over, the war's over, the war's over. And I looked at the little boy, and he says, "Oh, what a beautiful, lovely city Hamilton is. They've stopped the war. Nanny, let's live here forever and ever and ever." And a few days later, I was talking to my daughter, and I said, "I'm afraid there's going to be another war." And Chris says, "Don't worry, Nanny. We'll all go to Hamilton. There's never any fighting in Hamilton." And I just thought of the other day, if he could hear some of those broadcasts from the city council, he'd abrogate that statement.
You were, at one time, you were doing some broadcast with the CBC, and you were making some elephants.
Well, I was the beep beep mother-in-law on a soap serial. Not a very nice person. So I only had to work for half an hour, so I was in the toy business. And the Eatons wanted as many gray elephants as I can. They wanted gray plush. Well, as you know, trying to find gray plush or anything in the war was like, well, trying to find a barber shop in a hippie commune. You know what I mean? There just isn't one. So then I was coming down. I knew if I went to a casket company, I remembered that they covered some of the coffins with, I hope you don't mind, coffins with gray plush. And I figured the gray plush is 60 inches wide and the coffin's only that, and there should be some strips. So I came down to go to the Avril Casket Company. A friend of mine, Cyril Marsh, was held up with a big roofing job. You couldn't buy a roofing nail. That's
the
war.
This is because of the war.
Oh, absolutely. And he said, "If you're going to Hamilton, could you just go into every little, every hardware store and see what you can get me? If it's only a few nails," I said, "I will." So little Chris and I, after this lovely thing, the war's over, everybody was happy, we started at York Street, McNabb Street, now where would that be? And we got a few nails here and a few nails there, quarter of a pound here, and I had a big shopping bag, and then suddenly we found that lovely Reeves. Do you remember Reeves Hardware? Oh, I liked it. He let me have £2. Then I went on to the Avril Casket people. And the poor salesman looked for the nearest exit, because I said, "Could I have some of your strips of gray plush from your coffins? I want to make elephants." And I mean, he thought he'd have to phone the mountain and get the ambulance down. And I said, "No, it's true. You've got me right." He said, "Yes." He said, "I'll get you some." I think he was glad to get away. So then suddenly the bag burst. Remember the 10 pounds of roofing nails? And he came and he said, "Mrs. Gray, where?" And if you could ever see anything so incongruous, there we were, and the manager and some VIPs walked in, and there's the salesman and the little boy and the stout grandmother all on the floor grabbing the roofing nails and the coffins all around us. I mean, that's Hamilton. But it was wonderful. My toy business was saved, the man's roofing job was saved, the war was over, and we loved Hamilton.
One person got Jane Grey and Hamilton together, and that was Ken Sobel. And that's quite a story, isn't it, Jane?
Well, 1928, I had my own group of players, the first play ever to go on any radio in Canada. And I wanted businessmen, because actors wouldn't look at radio. And many came up to answer the call for a player's workshop, including a tall, fine young man, about 18, nice boy. And he asked if he could join our group, and I knew he wasn't an actor. I knew he wanted a wedge, and I liked him. I said, "Yes, what's your name?" "Ken Sobel." And he drove me back to my home, and he said, "Jane, I love radio. This is the first." He said, "Do you suppose I could ever own a station?" He said, I'm just a poor boy, but... I said, Ken, you're a fine young man. I like you. You're going places. If you want that radio station badly enough, you'll get it. He said, would you come and do some shows? I said, I will. And we shook hands on it. That was 1928. And in 1949, I had the call. And as the taxi drove up back to Hamilton and stopped outside the station, I said to the taxi driver, I got a lump in my throat, just stay a minute. And I looked. Remember, I had left a young man, eager with an impossible dream. And there stood a man in every sense of the word, married to a lovely woman, three beautiful daughters, and his own radio station. And I was so happy. Oh, I was happy. And I came for 2 months. We thought we'd try it for 2 months, and I stayed for 22 years, and I'm still here.
The people of Hamilton responded very generously to a lot of people. You were one of them. A lot of money was raised to send the war bride over to England.
She was dying of cancer, and it was Thursday morning, and I had her letter. And she wanted to know if she could possibly get back to her mother's home in Sussex by the sea, where she could take her little children, because she just had a few months to live. And I asked Mr. Melville Aitken, you know, that wonderful preacher from First United that was burnt down later, and the head of the Salvation Army to look after the funds, Thursday morning. I said, will you please, Mr. Aitken, ask God's blessing on the journey, because it's going to be a journey. I said to the people, all we need is 10 cents from each one of you. I'd like to see this lovely lady in her mother's arms at Sussex by the sea Sunday morning. Eaton's came forward and outfitted them all, not with bargain basement, the best in the store. She could have had a mink coat. The Salvation Army put everything aside. Everybody in Hamilton responded, I've never in my life. And I broadcast everywhere, in every England, Canada, all over the States, Panama. I've never seen response like it. These people of Hamilton are the most generous I've ever found. And she was in her mother's arms on Sunday morning with thousands of dollars in trust with the Salvation Army. She died, but her little children were looked after. And to this day, the Salvation Army of Hamilton still are looking after that little family.
Hamilton had been steadily, though at times rockily, expanding for nearly 100 years. But the city was still really a large town. It lacked the feeling of being a city, that attitude which hit other large centers. Hamilton was known as a big farm town. In 1950, that was all about to change. The Lawrence era had come to an end. And by an overwhelming vote, Lloyd Jackson was elected mayor. Many of the major projects just being realized today were begun in the Jackson years. Lloyd Jackson, unlike Sam Lawrence, represented the city's upper social strata. He was polished, educated, and had the amazing capacity to see far into Hamilton's future. Today, Jackson remains in seclusion in his home, the victim of a long illness. But Susan Jackson, the lady who stood by his side throughout his long administration, remembers those years and the events which filled them.
I found a reference to the fact that in 1944, he proposed that elementary schools and secondary schools in the city be built in such a way that they could be used as community centers. And this is something we're doing now.
Yes, well, that shows, that confirms the thing that has often been said about Mr. Jackson. He's a man of vision. And he's also a man of determination, if he thinks it's a worthwhile thing to go ahead with it.
What were some of the things that you remember of where he did do that, where he was determined?
Here in the city, do you mean? Well, you speak about the schools being left open after the school hours are closed. He felt that they should be used as a community center. The taxpayers pay for it. Therefore, the taxpayers should have the use to do, make use of it. And also, they, of course, impressed upon them that they have to be very tidy and leave things just the way they've seen it, where they've found them. This is the type of thing. As I say, he was sort of an organized mind, always following up everything that should be done in the order that it should be done.
quite a few of the big modern changes that have happened in Hamilton are traceable to the time when he was in office, if not in fact something that he did, at least the germ of the idea of what he did. Things such as what they did call the Shadoke Expressway, Highway 403, and the Skyway, Macassar Lodge, New City Hall, urban renewal, what has now been called Lord D. Jackson Square.
Yeah. Well, in doing this, he was able to persuade men of ability, education, to head up committees that would carry on. He was always very loyal to people like that and would give them the credit for what they had done. There was never one that wanted to have the credit himself. As long as this thing was carried out, this is the important thing. Who did it? Let them have the credit.
There was a long time getting to this new city hall. 1950 was a catch-up year. We'd just gone through the war and money had been scarce. And there was an influx of people to Hamilton, and there was a lot to be done that first year.
Yes, the city, in a way, had lain dormant, I would say, because of the lack of money and ambition. People have to have ambition themselves for what they're working for. Not for credit to themselves, but for the city itself. And this is what I felt was a very strong influence in my husband's mind. He was working for the city, but he wanted the people to work along with him and get the credit where credit was due.
But there was a lot of work for, well, redoing sidewalks and streets. There was the development of the mountain as a residential area. Many unpaved streets.
Yeah.
I understand he would get calls at home from people who were stuck.
Yes, over and over and over again, many, many a time. I would be answering the phone. I counted one time 100 times that they rang this phone, and I didn't answer it. Another time, 65 times. Mr. Jackson was sound asleep, and I wasn't going to disturb him. And therefore, I wasn't going to go to a telephone to argue with whoever was on the other end. So therefore, silence reigned. All but in our home, and that bell rang for unlimited time.
But I understand that people get their cars stuck in the new residential areas, new subdivisions, and he would go make calls on them and see what he could do to get them out.
Just the other day, the nurse here was saying about up in the mountains, she says, what Mr. Jackson has done for the people on the mountain, no person realizes. The roads were terrible. They were just in a sea of mud, isolated houses, and they'd have to put plank boards up to a place to get in to interview the person. And this is what he did. This is what he did. But he had the cooperation of his council and the Board of Control. I don't say that he does all these things by himself, but he was director of traffic.
There was a flooding condition at Van Wagner's Beach about 1950. And he got everybody involved in that, didn't he?
That flood, do you mean? Were you talking about the flood down at Van Wagner?
He got some members of council to go down with him to investigate the conditions and woke them up.
Yes, after the flood, after the day. Although that wasn't incorporated, that wasn't part of the city at that particular time. It wasn't under his jurisdiction or his council. This is what I understand, anyway. But I said, I know that the night of the flood, it happened to be the day of the, what do you call it, rugby game, the last rugby game of the season. And Mr. Jackson had gone over to Toronto with a number of people. He was a great one for handing out tickets to different ones. he enjoyed the game, therefore he thought other people would enjoy it. So this is what, and he didn't get home until after six. But in the meantime, when this flood was raging, our phone was just kept going. And I would make, I don't know how many times, or trips down the stairs to get some blankets. They were requesting blankets. And believe me, I couldn't get any of those blankets up out of that trunk because of the telephone ringing.
You did make some adventures as a couple, too, after and while you were involved in the city and Mayor Jackson were involved in these big projects. You went overseas to the coronation.
Yes, that was our first flight. And it was a hurried preparation because Mr. Jackson thought he would have the privilege of sending some other gentleman to represent the city instead of himself. So that he'd be at home, keeping the home fires burning, I suppose. However, the management at Ottawa would not permit it, said that if he and his wife couldn't go, that there wouldn't be any representative from Hamilton. So we took our first airplane trip. We came down at Goose Bay, and then on into London. It was a very, very thrilling, exciting. But you know, I thought I'd be awfully nervous. And here we were up thousands and thousands of feet in the air and seeing the clouds. And my husband said to one, Stuart, will you tell me when we're going over Three Rivers? And he said we were nearly Goose Bay at that time.
Now, you didn't go directly to the coronation. You made a side trip.
We had made arrangements ahead of time, really through the veterans here. They wanted us to put wreaths on the special cross, memorial cross, that had been made in Dieppe, the city of Dieppe, where we lost so many men on the 19th of August. So this is what we did. This picture is where we're standing in front of the cross, and the wreath is one that the veterans had given Mr. Jackson to place at the wreath, at the cross. Now these, I forget what they call these men, but Mr. Jackson contacted them before we ever went over from London so that everything would be in order. Now, present at this occasion was the Mayor Lamport of Toronto, a representative from the council in Montreal, Mayor Hood, he couldn't go, a Winnipeg alderman, a Rosetown alderman. They were all there. And they had a special meeting and had a special civic luncheon where I sat to the right of the mayor. And the mayor couldn't speak one word of English, nor could I speak any French. But I wasn't handicapped because there's always some person that can interpret for you. I happened to have the Attorney General of France beside me, and he would tell me what the mayor had said to me and in turn tell the mayor what I had replied. A very wonderful occasion. One of the most impressive and hard days we had ever had in our life in serving our Canada, as these pictures will show.
You placed Canadian flags on.
Yes, the Eatons, our Eaton company here, gave us little flags, Union Jacks, and they also, as the Eaton company always do, arrange for things. They carry out everything to the smallest detail, said that a man would come to our hotel in London and pick up the flags, have the standards, put them on standards, and have them back in time for our trip over to Dieppe. And this is what had happened. Now, previous to the putting on of the little maple leaves after the meeting that took place here, we had gone out, Mr. Jackson and I, and placed these flags at all the graves of the boys from this district and the surrounding districts. these little Union Jacks.
Going from the seriousness and the emotion of that trip to Dieppe, you also went on to something else which must have been a very happy occasion for you, representing the city of Hamilton, and that was at the coronation.
This is about, I would say, a quarter after six. And we were driven over to the to Westminster Abbey. And we were in a section K, I think it was, almost above the royal box.
What was in the little bag that you carried with you?
Well, could you make a guess?
I've never been to a coronation, and I've never carried a purse.
Well, it'd be naturally that I would take some of Jackson's produce with me. I had cookies from Jackson's, have Hamilton, and some lifesavers. Sitting ahead of us was the mayor of Ottawa. She had a bag full of stuff that she could have fed the whole group on that balcony.
You were going to be there for quite a while in the church, weren't you?
Oh, we were there. They really didn't start until 10 o'clock. And it was about, when it was all over, a man announced that none of us were to leave our seats until they were given the word. And when that came, we were allowed to go.
There were quite a few other dignitaries and the royalty that visited Hamilton, on the other hand. And we have some quite auspicious visitors to show.
Well, now this is the occasion when Princess Elizabeth and her husband, Duke Philip, were scheduled to come over to Canada on a trip right across Canada. But on account of the illness of her father, King George VI, they were delayed. Now, this happened to be on the 14th of October, but the week before, they were supposed to have come. And the week before, there was a terrible storm. We'd never been able to have had any reception or anything for the royal couple. So, on this day, when the prince and I were walking up the ramp, I told them about this terrible storm, and I said when we returned to our home, I went right over to the radio because I was so anxious to hear about the condition of our king, and this is what I heard. The royal couple, Princess Elizabeth and Prince Philip, are well across in the Atlantic, starting on their tour for Canada. And I looked up at the prince, who's a very tall, handsome man, and I said, do you know what I did right then? I stood stock still and prayed that our king would be returned to health and that you would have safe journey across our Canada. And I said, he didn't make one comment, but looked down at me and just shook his head. That's it. Now, this is Princess Margaret Rose, and she came. An entirely different type of person to her sister. Haughty, independent, and just seemed to be bent on getting there, as you can see in her stride here. The same setup for Princess Margaret Rose was arranged for at the CNR station. Now, lined along in the lower part of the station were the, I've forgotten the names of these people.
V.O.N.?
St. John's.
St. John's Ambulance.
St. John's Ambulance. And she, as she walked through, Mr. Jackson said something about them. She was the lieutenant colonel of these. She never paid any attention to that at all. She went on, and as we drove through the city and past the Queen Victoria's Monument, sitting in front of that were all the veterans. No comment was made. So on our return trip, after she'd made the trip, my husband said, now these, I understand you're the lieutenant colonel of these women here. Why won't you speak to them? And that Mrs. Fairclough, who was the minister from the government that had accompanied her here, said, she turned to her and she said, would you bring the captain to me? So the captain was brought and a few words were exchanged. Now that's the difference between our queen and Prince Marcus Rose. I have my own ideas about her, but I'm not going to express them.
He gave a great legacy to the city of Hamilton. And the things that he did and the things that he started, and you were very much a part of it all.
Well, I went along with everything he wanted to do. I kept my place. I had to keep my mouth shut, and as far as politics were concerned.
Ladies and gentlemen, the recipient of the first jewel award ever made by the Advertising and Sales Club of Hamilton, your citizens of the year, Mr. and Mrs. Lloyd Jackson. This has been, and I must speak of it, 13 years of possibly, I would say, the happiest, the really happiest years of my life, the busiest. I never knew prior to 1950 that I had it in me to work as hard as I have. I didn't know what I could do, and I say to the younger people here, particularly in this audience, you don't know what you can do till you have to do it.
Lloyd Jackson made Hamilton a city. He breathed life into it, and that is evident almost everywhere today. Rising like a phoenix from a dead urban core is a massive modern civic nucleus, which will stand as a living monument to his farsightedness, the Lloyd D. Jackson Square. When it is completed, it will contain two major office towers, two major department stores, a multi-level shopping concourse, a hotel, and countless other services. The undertaking is one of the most massive in North America. Who else but a brash and bold community such as Hamilton would level one half of the center of its city, the portion where most commerce is conducted, to rebuild it, and rebuild it in a single sweep, uniform, creative, artistic. The Civic Square is a model to other Canadian cities. It will be the continent's largest controlled civic mall. There will be no cars, no excessive pollution. All heating and car routes will be laid underground. At the same time, across King Street, a theater is being constructed, which will rank with that of Lincoln Center and the National Arts Center. The new Hamilton will feature concerts, ballet, plays, alongside a new art gallery. That gallery, looking to some like a pyramid, is a revolutionary new design, which will allow multi-level displays of art and give citizens a new and rich awareness of the great collection of art that's already here. Much of this has never been viewed because of lack of space at its present site. Hamilton has one of the world's finest collections of American art of the 20th century. Its Canadiana collection is superb, and our gallery ranks well within the top four or five collections in the country. The new cosmopolitan attitude of Hamilton is obvious and to be found in the little nooks which are appearing around the central core. James Street South is a gathering point for boutiques, antique shops, and art galleries. This area has some of the city's most interesting architecture, and a movement is gathering speed to have this part of Hamilton preserved as a reminder of the past, and still allow it to function as a sub-community within the hustle and bustle of the city at large. The dreams of Lloyd Jackson are being finally realized. But much of this is to the credit of the Vic Copps administration, which successfully hurdled a multitude of problems to bring Hamilton alive. What does the mayor foresee for the future? What will Hamilton be like even a decade from now?
This particular model is one of the two levels of the city showing a proposed rapid transit system for later on. But because this is just in the planning stage and will not occur for about 10 years from now, it's not really of as much interest to us as the things that are happening right now. I think it's very important and very fitting that in the 125th anniversary year, were doing things that are almost historic in terms of the changes that they're going to make in the city. And I'm thinking particularly of the Civic Square, the Jackson Square development, 43 acres of redevelopment, the largest urban renewal program in the central core of any city in the country, about $100 million of construction now underway with the first phase. And this has given us an opportunity to begin in the anniversary year, replacing the blight and decay of the past 125 years in the center of the city, and to create the kind of central core that the Jackson Square is going to make possible. Now, the big improvement here and the big revival here is not just in architecture and in bricks and concrete, but I think in the style of living in the city, that we are going to improve by the construction of the theater auditorium, which is one of the public uses in the Civic Square, and also the new library that should come later on, and the new art gallery. These things are going to provide amenities that are going to make Hamilton self-sufficient in terms of the arts and things of that kind. And of course, we're changing the atmosphere in Hamilton too. You know, we've always had the reputation as being the center of pollution and grime, I suppose, because we're an industrial city, and we are acquiring and developing a whole lot of new parkland and so on. But I think even more important is the work that's being done to improve the environment and to counteract pollution, particularly the sewage treatment plant, which is the largest municipal facility that's ever been built in Canada, and which is going to help us to clear up the harbor and restore pure water out there, which has become so contaminated by all the industrial development. Many other things going on that are going to make Hamilton, I think, a great city to live in, particularly for our young people to grow up in over the next few years. And it's certainly a wonderful opportunity that the council has to be here in the anniversary year when we're in the midst of so many great changes that have been so long in coming.
Mr. Mayor, I've heard the center of this city being described as a future jewel, and that it's going to attract people from all over Canada and the United States to come and see this. Do you agree with this?
Yes, I don't like to exaggerate too much. I'm always accused of doing that anyway in my hopes for the city, but there's no question it's going to make a tremendous change. I think it's going to be the finest redevelopment that's ever been done anywhere, and I know we're all going to be very proud of it, and certainly when these various elements of the square are completed and the new convention center is built adjoining the auditorium, and when the new hotel arrives in the square, this is going to make Hamilton a convention center. This by itself is going to bring a lot of visitors, and I know that they're going to enjoy it here, and I know that we're going to be proud of the kind of city we're going to have because of the things that are going on here in our 125th anniversary year.
The growth and development of Hamilton was no mere accident, nor was it the result of a carefully laid out plan by one or even a group of men. It was the evolution of a community of people, each arriving for his own purpose, each having his own idea and dreams. But together, they built a city. It has endured 125 years. By world standards, that's like a grain of sand in an hourglass. But its first century and a quarter of development has brought much envy. The future growth of Hamilton is surely up to us. Tom Cherington, good night.